I'm the curator of collections for the County of Santa Barbara, and I'm sure you haven't missed the fact that it is Poetry Month, April. And the reason I know is that the county did an official proclamation. I'm going to leave it out here. If any of you want to wade through all the whereases, you can read about it, but there's a lot going on. And we're very pleased to have this poetry evening tonight, Poets on the Threshold, organized by Paul Willis, City Poet Laureate. And I called him up very early because I knew April was going to be a busy month. So we're very happy to have him. And to coordinate this poetry reading with this very evocative Channing Peake exhibition, I hope you all had a chance to see it. Threshold, and it's by Allan Hancock College film and video instructors, Michele, Simonsen and her husband, Tim Webb. And the exhibition explores the beauty of light flowing through water in the Trinity River in Northern California. And many people don't know that it is photographed not with a digital camera, but a very old type of 35-millimeter film camera. And it's also photographed only with available light, which makes it all the more extraordinary. They often wait for hours for that one perfect sunbeam to penetrate the river and illuminate their subject. And so that's not unlike our poets tonight. Poet Stanley Kunitz said about writing poetry, "You have to remove the top of your head and plunge into the deep waters of the buried life in order to come up with words that are fresh and shining." So tonight I thank all the poets for doing their diving and coming up with all these fresh and shiny words. Tonight's poetry performance is being photographed as we speak and filmed by County TV. So at a later date, you'll start seeing it on television. If you go to the Santa Barbara County Arts Commission's website, we will also have a YouTube link, and you can watch it to your heart's content over and over again, I hope. Paul Willis is a professor of English at Westmont College and Poet Laureate of Santa Barbara for 2011-13. I also want to mention he's doing a Westmont downtown reading from 5:30 to 6:30 next Thursday, April 12th at the University Club at 1332 Santa Barbara Street, not very far. And if you need more information about that, we have some poetry schedules here and out on the counter in the gallery. And one thing I have learned just from meeting Paul a little bit, that when the art contains nature, the outdoor landscape, sky, water, or light, then he feels like he's in his element. He's at home and he's most inspired. So I want to welcome him to introduce our poets tonight. Thank you so much, Paul.
Thank you, Rita. Rita will be moving the images behind us as they change to match that the poems that our poets have brought us. And I got a haircut about a week ago, so I did get the top of my head removed. So I think I'm ready for this, Rita. There are seven of us who will be reading two poems apiece this evening. Mary Brown, Teddy Macker, Ron Alexander, Suzanne Frost, Randy VanderMey, Susan Chiavelli, and myself. And I've asked each one of us to wander through the gallery of these wonderful images that Tim Webb and Michele Simonsen have photographed on the Trinity River. And I asked each one of us, pick an image that you want to write a new poem about, and then pick another image, or perhaps the same image, in which you select an existing poem, either one you've written earlier or just another poem by another poet that's out there that connects to this image in some way. I didn't stipulate that everyone had to choose separate images, so you're going to see some repeated images here with some different poems and a chance to see how imaginations work differently in that way. Our first poet tonight is Mary Brown. Her poems have appeared in numerous journals and anthologies, most recently in Calyx, Fourth River, and Shadow and Light, a literary anthology on memory. Her manuscript, Disassembling the Body, was a finalist in a 2010 Gertrude Press chapbook contest. When not working on her poetry, she devotes her time raising funds for Planned Parenthood. Mary Brown.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Rita, for organizing this. And I don't think they're here, but I want to say thanks to the photographers for giving us this lovely, thought-provoking exhibit. So I was very taken by this photograph, and when I first looked at it, it suggested to me the Annunciation. And there's something spiritual about it and some sort of message being conveyed. And I've been interested lately in the number of ways that artists have depicted the Annunciation over the thousands of years. And part of me always hopes that there was some part of Mary that was a little bit rebellious. So this poem is called Mary at the River's Edge. All she hears is the wind, like a voice pulled through the roots of a storm-downed tree. All she wants is to swim in the river, still wearing her dress. Let the water press the skirt to her legs, not as baptism, but mermaid. The kingdom beneath is what draws her. She kicks down to bottom to drown the sound, and her mouth fills with a bitter taste. Fingers clutch the nape of her neck, pluck her up, and set her in the shallows on her knees. If the Holy Ghost is flame, what then the fish that gleam as she kneels in Trinity River? A tendril of hair escapes from her braid. She bows her head, but does not pray. And the second poem, picture I chose, I'm going to read a poem by an artist named Catherine Wing, who is originally from Kentucky, and she teaches poetry at Kent State. And this particular poem was featured in the Best American Poetry 2010. The Darker Sooner. Then came the darker sooner, came the later lower. We were no longer a sweeter here happily ever after. We were after ever. We were farther and further. More was the word we used for harder. Lost was our standard bearer. Our gods were fallen faster and fallen larger. The day was duller, duller was disaster. Our charge was error. Instead of leader, we had louder. Instead of lover, never. And over this river broke the winter's black weather. Thank you.
It was Mary Brown. Thank you very much, Mary. Our next reader is Teddy Macker, who describes himself as a husband, father and a gardener, and also a teacher at UCSB's College of Creative Studies. His work has been published widely. Teddy Macker, come on up.
I'm really grateful to be here. Thank you. I'm going to read two prayer-like poems. Poems that are, in a sense, similar to Mary's first poem. One's darker, and one's lighter, but I hope reverence is apparent in both. So this is just called prayer. Old mother who bore all the heavens, may you never be tamed. Thy kingdom come, our will be gone. On earth our only heaven. Please suffer us one more day, our onlyest bread. And forgive us the extinctions as we forgive those who might extinguish us. And lead us not into distraction, but deliver us from ourselves. Amen. For thine is the river, the mountain, the tree, now and forever. And the second poem is lighter. I mean, it's still a pretty heavy poem. And I was so taken by this little girl who brought to mind my daughter right away. We've had many beautiful afternoons at the San Ynez River together. And this is an older poem. And this is called prayer also. For the child in her stillness, for the Santa Ynez River, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For the iris locks of storm, the silk of the doling's lips, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For the backwards laugh of crow, stones in thunder's pocket, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For the opal mail of the dragonfly, the cloudy fur of the rabbit, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For scarlet macaw, flying fox, California poppy, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For the child pounded strangely in the smithy of nightmare, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For brother raccoon, dark heaving in the trap, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. For the hushed paws of the spider, put the weight on me, Lord, and humble me down. Thank you very much.
That's Teddy Macker. Thank you, Teddy. Our next reader is Ron Alexander, a trained psychologist, was for many years a counselor at UCSB, describes himself as a member of the Lazarus generation of people living creatively with AIDS. He got ready for the worst, and what happened was poetry. Ron is also hosting another event during Poetry Month. There are 21 poetry events this month in our community, and there are flyers up here listing them all. His is the Whitman Stein Poetry Fest, which has a separate flyer up here. It will be Saturday, April 21st, 7 to 9 p.m. in the Fabland Auditorium on the West Campus of Santa Barbara City College. Ron Alexander, come on up.
Thank you, Rita, and thank you, Paul, very much. I appreciate the opportunity to read. The woman in this photograph brought to mind the work of another photographer, Dorothea Lang, whose portraits of the Depression and the Dust Bowl in particular have become iconic. And the way she holds herself, the look in her face brought to mind the appearance of someone who suffered indescribable devastation. Even the gown could be of those times, but maybe when times were better, although it could be a nightgown. I wrote this poem in the empty room in response to this image. There's an epigram by Dorothea Lang. While there is perhaps a province in which the photograph can tell us nothing more than what we see with our own eyes, there is another in which it proves to us how little our eyes permit us to see. The empty room. Dust covers everything. Sifts in through cracks no thicker than the paper nailed to the front door. Finds its way into cupboards, closets, like floodwaters into shoeboxes in closets. Armageddon's aftermath on little white paper wrapped anklets. Dust in her locked keepsake box, where she put things she cared about when she cared about things. A child's New Testament, white leather, fits in her hand. Jesus' storms, nothing like hers. The man who loved her like a combine loves grain, his hands burn now like a smith's tongs, hot from the forge. No grain raised here since 36, and the combine sold to pay the mortgage. In the small room, empty as her body, green sea lions allemand on muslin curtains, and grief, like water, finds its own level. Across the continental divide, her sister, voice like a mallet, lectures, don't dwell on what ain't. Reminds her their cousin in Cimarron County lost two to the dust pneumonia, and she don't cry. Tells her to go to church, but her sins line up like the sagebrush caught in barbed wire along the highway. She dreams of thunderheads, rain, standing on a lake like the Lord. As far as she can see, dark waters spill out to the edges of her life. No shore in sight. The second photograph of the woman walking in the waterbed, her feet in the waterbed, a large stone in her hands, reminded me of Virginia Woolf, who in the winter of 1941 filled her pockets with stones and walked into the River Ouse, drowning herself. This is a poem by Paula Bohintz, published in Poetry Magazine, December 2010, and by way of explanation of the title, The Great Ouse is the name of the river in which Woolf drowned herself. Entering the ooze. First the bad boots give up their strength. Then the toes lift their anchors. The ankle bones are broken and so on until the bladder lets go without shame and the genital organ washes away the ovum and her fertile signals. A proxy pain stands in for the larger intangible. has nothing to do with tufts of snow blown upon the unforgiving surface, but how I mistook the beauty of those particle deaths there, of the world stardom, as a kind of metaphysical river, that if I looked long enough, with enough reverence, let my waist, bled numb, stand in for that miscalculation. And the severed friendships in the current's wake, the bloom blown off the stricken self. I saw formal water, knowing my body wanted to go there. My only child, how I've betrayed you. Thank you.
That's Ron Alexander. Thank you, Ron. And thank you all for coming out this evening on a first Thursday. It's a joy to have you here with us. Our next reader is Suzanne Frost. Suzanne studied English literature at Scripps College in Claremont and UCLA as an undergraduate before receiving her Bachelor of Arts in English and Philosophy and a Master of Arts degree in English and Creative Writing from the University of New Mexico. And while in New Mexico from 1985 to 98, she served on the board of the Taos Poetry Circus and other arts organizations. In Santa Barbara, she was the co-founder, editor, and publisher of Sage Trail Poetry Magazine and currently directs the Poetry Zone monthly poetry series at the Karpeles Manuscript Library, two blocks down Anapamu. The Poetry Zone reading this month will be 2 p.m. Saturday, April 14th. Suzanne will host it and will feature the poet Jan Steckel. So, Suzanne, come on up.
Well, I'm so grateful and I'm so thrilled to be here. I'm grateful to the county for putting on such a great arts event, mixing visual art with word art. So I have the same initial feeling that Ron had with this painting. Darkness, grief, depression, maybe even suicidal, it's hard to say. And then it reminded me of my dear poet friend who passed away, who did commit suicide maybe 3 or 4 years ago, Catherine McCracken. But then I had an epiphany. And I turned her into the creator of the world. Just for the fun of it. Euronome's return. And also, I just wanted to mention that this poem looks at both paintings that I'm looking at. Euronome's return. Dance across the waves, Euronome, above water. Dance across the waves. With the lute and the drum, you waltz the day into creation. Separate the dark river from the sky. Are you looking for the world you haven't made yet? Fishtailed queen of heaven, naked you rose from chaos before Cronus and Zeus, first creator of all things, with river gods' sons, mother to the graces of splendor, festivity, and rejoicing. Those boulders you chase in living color underwater, are they destined to be seabed, or are you building our future inspiration? Dance across the waves, Euronome. Above water, dance across the waves. And since I had remembered my dear friend, I looked in her book that she's had published, Earth Dreams, and found one about a river and and beavers. It's called Beaver Pond. They have returned to the Taos Mountains, headwaters of a Talia ditch, where raspberries grow wild beside boulders to the Rio San Antonio. Here at the dam, I can smell them, a bitter mask on dark water. Tails slap dawn if you listen, the wet of cottonwoods surrounding cattails, lupin and marsh Irish glow in the dark blue, purple penstemon, bite of yarrow. They're taking over, eating the names of the Frenchmen who trapped them, Gentet and Thibodeau. Currents punctuate the flavor of morning. Canyon wrens background the music of hills. The beaver are eating the present, gnawing the future, the backlog of waters growing toward flood. How far to meanders as wide as valleys? To beaver children thick in the marsh, eating a silence surrounded by birdsong. To a flourish of boulders and cicadas. How long to flickers pumping the trees alone? To a silence of chainsaws rusting. To highways returning to rubble. To vehicular suicide. And if I told you, yes, let it come, that the messages they carry in teeth and tail speak to my feet in these congestions of willow, and to my nose again as the bitter water turns in its confinement, birthing a flood, then would you follow me onto the pale brown slander of heaved dirt, thick with its flow, or would you skip a stone on the dark flat tail of the beaver's pond and blister your tires hard on the rock bridge above as you left?
That's Suzanne Frost. Thank you so much, Suzanne. Our next reader is Randy VanderMey. Randy's a colleague of mine in the English department at Westmont College, and he's the chair of our department. He's originally from Michigan, has an MFA not in poetry but in fiction from the University of Iowa, but writes a fair amount of poetry as well and loves to rise to the challenge of occasional poetry. He is the author of several best-selling composition textbooks published by Houghton Mifflin, and his most recent book of poetry, published by Artemo Press, just down Anapamu at the Artemo Gallery, is Charm School, Five Women of the Odyssey. Randy, come on up.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Rita, and thank you, County. I've seen a lot of televised goings on in this room, and none of them seemed as wonderful as this. There's a balance that we're striking, I think. Well, oh, and thank you to the photographers who have created images that have haunted me for the last month since I was given this challenge. I'm sure that all of the poets feel that way. This one, this was probably the one that, I thought I was going to read the other. This is one that I'm going to read a poem by someone else. This is not the one I wrote a poem about, so let me begin with this one. I'm going to read a poem called Aphrodite by a poet I do not know called Olga Brumas. And I find it in this book, Gods and Mortals, Modern Poems on Classical Myths. Usually you think of Aphrodite as somebody rising up out of the sea, and it never occurred to me to think about what she was doing moments before when she was still under the water. And it never occurred to me to think of her with a huge rock in her hands, either about to catch one or throwing one away. Well, the rock is featured in this poem, Aphrodite. And it's really about all women. The one with the stone cups and the stone face and the grinding stone settled between her knees. The one with stone in her bosom, with stones in her kidneys, a heart of pure stone. The one with the stony lips, the one with the thighs of marble, with genitals, the one whose glance turns to stone. This idol stones through her ears, stones round her neck, her wrists, round her fingers, a stone in her navel, stones in her shoes. This woman, so like a stone statue, herself a stone, stands in the stone square midway between the stone high steeple, the stone round well, a stone in her stone still hand and a stony will, waiting for what will land stiff as a long stone on the grinding stone on her lap. I thought it was uncanny how those two things went together. And I wrote a poem about this one. The weirdness of it just stayed with me. I ended up writing a poem called Chiasmus. For those of you who've not taken a rhetoric class for 30 years, chiasmus is a figure of speech in which the first element and the second element are reversed in order the second time around. So A, B, B, A structure. Like, ask not what you can do for your country. I mean, ask not what the country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. That sort of pattern. And I've subtitled it, Or 13 Ways of Looking at a Nymph Looking at a Nymph. So this is about haiku length portions, each one numbered. Number one, Athene, Persephone. Persephone, Athene. I'm going to give time for these to sink in. Number two, I would flow full-fledged from memory to ether. Number three, which wavering one of us three, including me, pours more light into the others? Number four, is one of us the other's dream? Which one of us would know? Number five. We swim into the other's ken like comets, asteroids, space debris. Number six, I come to breathe. Come you down to drink? Number seven, kiss me in the way of friends. You think me, I'll think you. Thank you for those little breaths. That means everything to a reader, I'll tell you. I could quit right now and I'd be happy, but. Number eight. Shall we invite someone else or keep it just us? Number nine. I think we're being watched. Number 10. I was raising this rock to show or throw. Now I'm having second thoughts, so no. Number 11. Is this how I appear when I aspire? What are you trying to tell me, dear? Number 12. My approach has made us possible. My emergence will destroy us. Number 13. Oh, I just saw something. There's actually 14, and I misnumbered them. It's a fresh poem. It'll take some reworking. Number 13. Time is a tympanum. In a moment, all may perish in a dragon roar. I cherish this, the sound of bubbles, triangles, bells. And what's numbered 13 but is actually 14 and last. How do photos, how do poems strain to mean? Are they Siamese twinned to our brains? Are they what we think? Or is the secret in the drink? Is there finally more in all this fuss than us? Thank you.
Randy VanderMey. Thank you, Randy. There's two more of us to read, unless Randy's poem gets longer in the next 10 minutes. Then we'll bring him back up. Our next reader is Susan Chiavelli. Her award-winning stories, essays, and poetry have appeared in Chattahoochee Review, New Millennium Writings, Minnetonka Review, 580 Split, Other Voices, Rattle, and elsewhere. She is a recipient of the Lamar York Prize for Nonfiction, the John E. Profant Foundation for the Arts Literature Award, and a Wilding Art Museum Poetry Prize. Susan, come on up.
Thanks, Paul and Rita. And I don't know if the photographers snuck in. Are they back there? No? Oh, okay. Well, I wish they were here. I had the pleasure of meeting them in March when they came for the first Thursday in March. And I don't know if everyone knows, but it's a husband and wife team. And not only did they explain their photographic techniques, they explained their deep love of the Trinity River. And I think that shows in their work. And the little girl in the photographs is their daughter. There's my girl. Okay. I was in a kind of a dark place when I wrote this poem. We had just learned that a friend of ours knew someone whose daughter committed suicide on the day I wrote the poem. And I'm first going to read a poem. I went back into the past to pull out by Hilda Doolittle, often known as HD. I think she wrote this in 1912, and it's called Pursuit. What do I care that the stream is trampled? The sand on the stream bank still holds the print of your foot. The heel is cut deep. I see another mark on the grass ridge of the bank. It points toward the wood path. I have lost the third in the packed earth. But here a wild hyacinth stalk is snapped. The purple buds, half ripe, show deep purple where your heel pressed. A patch of flowering grass, low trailing, you brushed this. The green stems show yellow-green where you lifted, turned the earth side to the light. This and a dead leaf spine split across show where you passed. You were swift, swift. Here the forest ledge slopes. Rain has furrowed the roots. Your hand caught at this. The root snapped under your weight. I can almost follow the note where it touched the slender tree, and the next answered, and the next, and you climbed yet further, and you stopped by the dwarf Cornell, whirled on your heels, doubled on your track. This is clear. You fell on the downward slope. You dragged a bruised thigh. You limped. You clutched this larch. Did your head bent back search further, clear through the green leaf moss of the larch branches? Did you clutch, stammer with short breath and gasp? Wood demons grant life, give life, I am almost lost. For some wood demon has lightened your steps. I can find no trace of you in the larch cones and the underbrush. And then the poem I wrote is in response to Hilda Doolittle's poem and also the photograph. Escape. What do I care that you tracked my clumsy exit from this broken world? You may keep the sand from my final footprint. Scoop it in your hand or confine it to an hourglass. The plunge is mine. What did I last see through the green leaf moss of the larch branches? I saw the constant sky holding a piece of moon, as it did before I was born and will after. I did not clutch or grasp at anything of heaven or earth, for I have no need of angels or wood demons. They belong to you. The sky offered nothing. It keeps infinity for itself. I embrace the memory of water. Twisted in the falling, my face appeared on the surface as that of a stranger's looming closer, until I broke through. For a moment, I was on the longest journey, half in one world, half in the other, then surrender. I float suspended in the forgiving womb. You will find no trace of me. You may keep the sand from my final footprint and the crushed purple of the broken hyacinth and the apparition of your face as you search for me, but find only yourself reflected from the gray-green Trinity. Thank you.
That's Susan Chiavelli. Thank you, Susan, so much. Well, I saw this image behind me, and I thought of Ophelia from Hamlet. And the title of the poem that I wrote, it's called "The Fair Ophelia Hesitates on the Trinity River." She looks as if she is about to go on stage, recalling her lines, "How does your honor?" before she floats into the dark waves of performance. But soft, her cue has not yet come, and the wind and current keep eternal house without her. The rock shelving on the bank provides the perfect seats within this theater, where nothing yet is happening except for the soliloquy of a barren snag. To be or not to be, it says, but clearly it has chosen to be, a white angle of resistance, while our heroine waits and waits and waits, testing the waters like a willow. Well, this image, of course, reminds us even more of Ophelia. It's reminiscent of some of those 19th century paintings of her floating there. 7 years ago, David Starkey at City College and I co-edited this book, In a Fine Frenzy, Poets Respond to Shakespeare. And we put out a request for poems responding to Shakespeare's works. Got a lot of poems in the mail and got far more poems about Ophelia than any other character in Shakespeare. In fact, we wrote in the introduction, had we accepted all the Ophelia poems, they would have drowned this book. Each of them very interesting, and interesting to think why Ophelia has caught hold of our imagination, especially in current times. So I've chosen a poem by Kathleen Lynch, who lives in Sacramento. And since I moved Ophelia to the Trinity River in California, I thought I would read her poem called Ophelia in Utah. I lay down singing, down in the glassy stream, my arms laden with crow flowers, nettles, my mouth still telling prayer and songs of grief, My mind, they say, gone. Oh, father, brother, lover, those heavy skirts and what I carried bore me down, and under the green water I left you my body to plant. Imagine my surprise when not just time passed, but all space and dimension, and I surfaced farther away than you or I could ever imagine. This is a lake of salt where all tears come to rest, and I am buoyant here, bare under a very bare sky, completely awake now and curious. I carry nothing but words. What have they named the flowers in this wind-blown place? Who will I meet if I rise up, walk to the far road? I will say, here I am. I will wear the one face God gave me. The water is a vast, breathing thing. It grows dark beneath me, dark and deeper still. Thank you, and I want to thank all our poets. Rita, did you want to come up again?
I want to thank the poets for their incredible generosity of creativity. I was very touched so many times. It's, you know, people don't realize how much work goes into a poem, and then to get that craft, that one perfect image that touches us, it's just so amazing. So thank you. Thank you so much. And again, it will be on County TV. We'll have it on our website, a YouTube. So do watch it again, and I thank you again. Thank you, Paul. That was great.